I don't have to say that 2020 was strange, right? A year that we'll never forget. While a lot of that year was pretty shitty, let's be honest, it was a big year for our industry. This was due to everyone having to stay inside and finding new ways to pass the time. This caused an increased interest in VR, but we also got new VR headset releases which helped, like Oculus Quest 2 and the HP Reverb G2. Some amazing games released The Walking Dead and Half-Life Alyx. So since this is the first episode in January, I wanted to do a VR year in review, for which I've collected statistics from our industry and they're actually really exciting. We may be very close to going mainstream. Hello, I'm Cass and welcome to the first Updates Friday of 2021, where I'll talk about the latest VR news and highlights of the last few weeks. And today, we won't be only talking about numbers, but also the fact that we may be close to Sword Art Online, but maybe even closer to a Ready Player One Oasis, and so much more. So let's just get started and join me for today's update.
But Cass, wait!
Huh?
But Cass, wait!
What? Oh. A big thanks to Antlion Audio for being today's sponsor. I'm excited to talk about their microphones as I've been using theirs for years now. You may have noticed it. We are here in a mission already.
Whoa!
Yes, my voice is recorded here with the ModMic Wireless, the world's first ever attachable microphone. It uses a magnet that sticks to almost any surface, like your favorite headphones or a VR headset. Using the provided USB, you can capture your voice wirelessly with low latency. Battery life is great as well, with 12 hours, and since it's on your head, it provides a consistent sound quality even if you're moving around a lot, so it's the perfect companion for any VR content creator or if you like to play show you VR games. I also like the fact that over the years I could easily reuse it with any headset, and I haven't even said that I think it sounds great. I mean, I'm using it right now, so judge for yourself. Now, if you want to upgrade your audio, click the link below and make sure to use the code casandchary to get 15% off your order. Let's start with Steam VR. Valve shared some statistics. In 2020, there were 104 million VR sessions in total, 1.7 million first time VR users were added, the average VR playtime is increased by 30%, averaging about 32 minutes per session. VR game revenue has increased by 71%, apparently not even counting the launch of Half-Life Alyx, which added an additional 39% on top of that. Nice flex, Valve. But last year we also surpassed the 2 million milestone of monthly connected headsets on Steam VR. And even months after, this stayed consistently above the 2 million mark. This is an estimation by Road to VR, who analyzed the Valve's data. Do keep in mind that this is data of headsets that were connected and doesn't indicate how many were actually used. So to put this into perspective, it took 40 months to get to 1 million and then just 7 months after to reach 2 million. Of course, this is only on Steam VR, so Quest users without a PC are not even included. But on that note, let's talk Oculus numbers. Facebook, unfortunately, doesn't share hard numbers. However, there are some indicators. Andrew Bosworth, the head of Facebook Reality Lab, said that the Quest 2 surpassed the original Quest's monthly active people in less than 7 weeks. And during Facebook's fourth quarter earnings call was shared that over 60 Oculus developers are generating revenue over $1 million. In March 2019, there were only 20 developers. During the call was also noted that the company's non-advertising revenue increased with 156% year over year, and that the Quest 2 drove this increase. But the most interesting thing is what this means for VR developers. They also shared some stats. Cloudhead Games, developers of Pistol Whip, shared that its sales were up 60% in 1 year. Skydance Interactive's The Walking Dead Saints and Sinners made over $29 million in revenue in its first year on sale. And the following number may not be as indicative, but it's interesting. Growth is also seen in other places. For example, VR subreddit's growth has skyrocketed over the past years. And with these already positive numbers, it's also interesting to know that the lack of headset availability likely held back those numbers. So yeah, VR basically basically rocked 2020. But what about the following years? Well, a large consumer market researcher, IDC, forecasts that worldwide spending on AR and VR will accelerate out of the pandemic, growing from just over $12 billion this year to $72.8 billion in 2024. Not strange, as organizations of all sizes are leveraging XR to capture and transfer knowledge, streamline field operations, and increase collaboration without physical contact. This has to make an impact in the upcoming years. For gamers, the upcoming big titles will certainly make an impact, like Sniper Elite, Splinter Cell, and Assassin's Creed VR. So yeah, VR is far from that. And I hope that more companies will start seeing these numbers and start making use of it. Come on guys, there's money to make here. But how long do you think it will take before VR goes mainstream? Give me your predictions in the comments below. Let's move along to hardware news. Valve co-founder Gabe Newell talked about his future vision for brain-computer interfaces, or BCI. They entered a new partnership with OpenBCI, a neurotech company behind open source non-invasive BCI. Newell wants to bring high-resolution mind-reading technologies built into headsets. He says this will allow developers to one day create experiences that are much better than what a player could do with their eyes, ears, arms, or legs right now. This technology could be used for many things in the future, but for now, we can only guess what is possible. However, it does sound like he's basically making the NerveGear from Sword Art Online. In that anime, a user can enter a game with body and mind, so they could feel all senses inside the game, like touch or tasting. This does seem like something very far away, but Newell does say research is going much faster than anticipated. Of course, there are risks as well, like imagine what if developers could make you feel pain in their games. Some scary things could happen, but honestly, I kind of still want it. But as early as 2022, studios could have test units in their labs. Newell also has a message for software developers: start thinking about using BCI now, because it's going to be important to all aspects of the entertainment industry fairly soon. And can you imagine this technology together with these HaptX gloves DK2? These are recently revealed new versions of the haptic gloves. These have true contact haptics, 133 points of tactile feedback per hand that pushes against your skin to replicate the texture of virtual objects, allowing you to feel like you're touching something real. Unfortunately, it's still for enterprise and there's no news for the consumer yet. But Apple is rumored to release a standalone VR headset next year. It will display an all-encompassing 3D digital environment for gaming, watching video, and communicating. But the AR capabilities will be more limited. Bloomberg News reported this, but keep in mind, it's still being finalized and could be subject to cancellation. Knowing Apple though, it's likely going to be expensive. But talking about expensive things, Canon is launching their $38,500 mixed reality headset in February. The Canon MREAL S1. It's a cool looking, lightweight one that can be head mounted or used handheld. But you know, since you can buy a pretty nice car with that price, let's move on to an upcoming VR headset that's going to be interesting for everyone. This is the UNAI, both a headset and a virtual world designed to make VR social interactions a whole lot better. It comes from the creator of the open source VR headset Relatively, which you can build yourself for about $200. The UNAI is a tetherless all-in-one headset that uses a dedicated box to connect to the headset wirelessly. It will also include 9 cameras and 2 microphones with facial features and full body tracking. This may remind you of the XR Space Manova and the DecaGear, all designed for similar social experiences. And well, it sounds like they're all trying to get us closer to a real Ready Player One Oasis. I'd love to see some working products still, but I am rooting for them.
Okay, let's see what you got, Oculus.
Thank you.
Sorry, I thought this was mega funny, so I wanted to include it. I think this was a bit of a step towards the Oculus Quest commercials, which you must have seen, and while they were super cool and well made, it may also give the wrong expectations to someone entirely new to the industry, a kind of an expectations versus reality thing. Anyways, on that note, let's get to software news. Oculus Multi-user Accounts and App Sharing are coming next month to Oculus Quest. This means you can use multiple accounts on one headset. Every user still needs a Facebook account though, so bear that in mind, but it means that the primary account holder can add a secondary account to their device and share the apps they purchase with these secondary accounts. Game progress and achievements will then be saved separately per account, which is really nice. There are some conditions which you can read from this blog post, link is below, but it's not super clear yet still what this all means for things like playing multiplayer games when you only bought the game once. So I'll definitely be testing this out with Chary once this feature is out, so stay tuned. Google has sadly moved away from actively developing Tilt Brush. However, the good news is that they have open sourced it. This means that the code is now available for any developer who wants to learn or make use of it, and in less than 24 hours, developers have already prototyped a multiplayer feature, and there's already a free copy of Tilt Brush on Side Quest called Side Sketch. Tilt Brush was one of the first experiences we tried on a consumer VR headset, and it was one of those things that sold VR to us, so it will always have a special place in my heart. But while we talk about Quest, Gorn was released yesterday on Quest, and so move that furniture away, make sure you are nowhere near valuable equipment and walls, because this is an over-the-top, super violent gladiator fighting game, and you are most likely going to punch and dodge like crazy. I think this is the game that has killed the most televisions, so be warned, but do go have some gladiator fun. It's a nice game, especially if you are looking to let off some steam. Gorn is available now for $20 on the Quest store. And for those who have been waiting, Beat Saber finally got 90Hz support on Oculus Quest 2. I Expect You to Die, a very cool VR spy adventure game from Shell Games, was released back in 2016 and is now getting a sequel sometime this year. I Expect You to Die 2, The Spy and the Liar is for now only listed on Steam, so for PC VR headsets. No news yet on whether it will come on Quest or PSVR yet, but I think it would be strange if it wasn't. Now, something to try out if you got some time, Big Screen is bringing free on-demand movies to the app. If you don't mind watching some ads, that is. Film availability depends on your physical location, although you could probably make use of a VPN. But in the US, you could watch titles like Arrival, Blair Witch, Paranormal Activity 4, and more. I also got two pretty exciting upcoming games. ID Software and Bethesda could be working on a new VR game, maybe another Doom in VR. On an Australian game classification website, a new listing named Project 2021A was spotted. The listing shows media type as virtual reality and an R18+ classification for high impact violence and online interactivity. It also says Bethesda Softworks is the publisher and ID Software as the author. I'm very curious. And last year it was announced Ubisoft is bringing Splinter Cell and Assassin's Creed to VR. Hype overload. But now a Ubisoft job listing for Splinter Cell strongly suggests that they might be adding a multiplayer feature to the game. There's really no doubt. So pretty cool, but we still don't know when it will come. Hopefully this year though. Don't forget to let me know your favorite piece of news of today, and of course your predictions of when VR will be mainstream. This time, shout out to our handsome mod KCB for posting the Valve BCI post on our Discord. I also welcome you to join in and post VR news, and maybe I'll include it in the next video. Invites are down below. Thanks for watching this Update Friday. Stay healthy, and a special thanks go to all our champions, especially these patrons down below, and as always, VR on!